What we're going to look at is, let me get some scriptures out and take us from where we are teaching on predestination and pre-existence, the two topics combined together. And I want to thank those who online have written to Wee-Leng and told me the spelling of Arminianism should be with an I. Thank you very much. That's a good correction. And so Arminianism should have been with an I and not with an E. And E will be a country, actually. And so thank you for that. And in the book of, let's look at the book of Ephesians. In Ephesians chapter 1, we talk about predestination. And remember, if you need more scriptures and more light on this, our earlier topics covered very thoroughly the scriptures. And so today we summarize in order to move into something new that God has for us. In the book of Ephesians chapter 1, it says here, from verse 1 to verse 6, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ, just as He chose us in Him before the foundation of the world." See, that's your pre-existence there. Before the foundation of the world. And we talk about Jesus knew He was pre-existent. In John chapter 8, he said, "Before Abraham was, I am." And then we talk about how some people knew about their pre-existence. Jeremiah did, because the Lord says in chapter 1, "Before you were formed in the womb, before you formed the womb, I knew you." And then we also talk about David, who also knows his pre-existence. He wrote Psalms 139. And then we also know people Paul knew about his pre-existence. He writes about it right now. Only the one who saw the pre-existence can write about it. Only when he saw how God chose us can he write about it. All these things that he writes and he downloads. His downloads are there. So Paul was one of the people who knew. Moses also knew it. Moses said in the book of Psalms chapter 90, in the first few verses, "Lord, you have been our dwelling place from before the worlds were made." Remember, Moses saw all the way back to Adam and Eve, and he wrote the book of Genesis. So there are Bible people who knew their pre-existence and who have a connection that back with their pre-existence. There's some knowledge that was there. And so based on that pre-existence, we knew Jesus had chosen us before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before Him in love, having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to Himself, according to the good pleasure of His will, to the praise of the glory of His grace, by which He made us accepted in the beloved. I have to answer one question that one person is hearing online right now, and he's a minister. He's asking God that question. I just had a flash vision. And sir, you in the ministry that's hearing this, and the question you just asked God, and because of God's love to you, and you say, you just said, "Father, I want to do miracles like I'm seeing right now online." And you say, "What should I do?" This is the answer that the Lord says. If you want to move in miracles, have love for sick people, the way Jesus have. Have compassion on the sick people. And it just not just empathy or sympathy, but compassion. The compassion of God, from the root word splachna, it's one of the words for compassion. Elio is the other Greek word for compassion. There are two Greek words for compassion. And the reason is this: all healing flows from the life of God, correct? It's the life of God that heals. The life of God has two other dimensions. The life of God is also the light of God. John chapter 1. In Him was life, and the life was the light of man. Now, the life of God and the light of God in 1 John, same author, John, tells us in 1 John chapter 1 and chapter 2 that when you walk in love, you walk in light. When you don't walk in love, you walk in darkness. So remember, as Christians, every day of your life, everything you do to someone, everything that you add, check, is this love? Is this walking in love? Are your actions walking in love? If they are not, sorry for you, as a Christian, you could be walking in darkness. And that has consequences. So, First John tells us in 1 John chapter 1 and chapter 2 that when you walk in love, you walk in light. So you notice the three words, life, light, and love are all connected. They are three views of the substance of God. It is the substance of God. The substance of God is His life. Substance of God is light, because God is light. Substance of God is love. And these are the three words that are having use of God. God is light. God is life. God is love. You remember the word is means it's interchangeable. Love is God. The fullness of love is God. Life. And these are the fullness of God's attributes. And because love, light, and light are all related, in order to channel the healing of God through your words and through your ministry, sir, and any one of you here, you must feel, because it flows through your soul and through your mind. You must feel, you must think, and you must choose. After all, your soul is your mind, your emotion, and your will. It's in your spirit, no problem, but it's flowing from your soul that is a problem. So you must choose love, you must choose to love, you must think loving thoughts, you must feel the love of God. Then your soul becomes an instrument. Then the healing of God flows through your spirit, through your soul, and then through your touch and body and words that your body expresses. So, sir, the question of one minister who is right now asking God that Jesus loves you so much that He interrupt me to give you this answer, that you want to move in the anointing of God for healing signs and wonders, and greater signs and wonders, have the love of God for people. Only when you have complete love and feel that love of God for the sick, the dying, the suffering, of course, the poor, the people who are going through all this, when you know and feel the love of God for them, and that love increase, and then you want to do something to channel God's love and energy to them, then God will use you in the gifts of the Spirit, healing signs and wonders. Catherine Kuhlman felt that before she started signs and wonders. And all of you right here, sitting here, you're among the 500, and those some of you hearing this word, you're among the 500 that we're going to raise to bring signs and wonders. There are 1,001 principles how to operate things. Faith, confession, different things. But the essence of all principles is this. You must have the love of God for people. And that love flows through your spirit, through your soul, through your body to them. Then healing is full. So that's the key. Alright? So, it's given to you. There's a side sermon out there for somebody. In the book of Ephesians, it says that we have been chosen in verse 4, before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before Him in love. There are still a lot of miracles happening, right? If I keep calling out, we end up with a healing services, right? I could sense someone with some sort of growth in the neck area. But remember, just open yourself, whatever, when you see in God's presence, receive your healing. And having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ with Himself, according to the good pleasure of His will, to the praise of the glory of His grace, by which He made us accepted in the beloved. Notice that in the end, in verse 5, all that blessings we receive is to do God's will. See, the good pleasure of His will, not our will. And then the other thing is verse 6, to bring praise and worship to Him. Not to gain attention ourselves, but everything that God has done must help everyone to bring them closer to God. And that all will become greater and greater and deeper worshippers of God. That's the ultimate goal. And then you talk about all that Jesus has done. Go to chapter 2 of Ephesians. And this is the part which we already covered. God, who is rich in mercy because of His great love. Again, He keeps emphasizing the love of God. Can you see that? And even when Paul talks about signs and wonders in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, signs and wonders of the apostle, and all these signs and wonders, and even when He talks about the gifts of the Spirit, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, what is after he talked about gifts of spirit in 1 Corinthians 12, what did he talk about in the next chapter? See, you cannot escape it. You have to have love to operate in signs and wonders, which is different from the way the enemy works, of course. And the enemy are four signs and wonders and does not have the agape love of God. But the love of God is tied to the works and the mighty works and acts of God. So we have here in the book of Ephesians chapter 2 that it says, because of his great love, which he loved us even before the foundation of the world, even when we were dead in trespasses, he made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up together, made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. That means we're seated there and God still wants to show greater signs and wonders. Because, and remember, the sentence hasn't ended in verse 7. The sentence started from verse 4. Which means in verse 7, he's still emphasizing the greatness of his love. They continue to flow upon us. And continue to flow through us. God just wants to show us how much he loves us. So that we grow more and more in love with our God. And also important, that we love one another more. That is his commandment. So in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches and grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. And that's a part where we say, we are all right now sitting in the heavenly places. There's a part of us that's seated in the heavenly places in God. But at the same time, we are down here. So there seems to be two parts. The first thing you observe is that there is like a dual existence. There is a part of you here, a part of you in Christ. You never left the heavenly places. You're always in the heavenly places, seated in heavenly places. But there is a distance between where heaven is. In terms of geography, there's a distance in space and time. Although in the spirit, there's no space and time. But in the time-space continuum, there is a distance between heaven and here. So you see two parts of your being. And this is like quantum theory, where you exist in two states of being. That's quantum. And then besides the area of existing in two states, notice it exists beyond the time sphere. Because when Christ was risen from the dead, none of us were born again. None of us were born again or even physically born yet. See, at most of us are born in the 20th century. And some of us might be, anyone born? Okay, there might be some of the young ones could be born in the 21st century. But most of us are born in the 20th century. And so I don't see anyone born in the 1890s. Anybody here, put your hand. Okay, there's not. So most of us are born in the 20th century, 21st century, the young ones. But Christ rose from the dead in the first century. There's a time difference of nearly 1,900 years. So how is it possible that you physically didn't exist yet and you were risen with Christ in the first century? When your physical existence only came about in the 20th century or 21st century, but 1,900 years or 2,000 years ago, Christ rose and you were there. So obviously, the second point is not just a time continuum separation. There was also something beyond time. It's beyond time. And that's why it talks about pre-existence. And the spiritual realm is beyond time. It has happened even before you were born on earth. Before you came to the earth, it already took place in Christ. Either that or it took place here, and you were linked back into the time when Christ rose from the dead. Can you see? Time continuum is out also. It's two forces. With this in mind, and understanding predestiny and pre-existence, we continue further. Remember, we are not covering everything in one session, so we flow as we go along. And that's where I need these little diagrams that we have here. Yeah, we have diagrams at the back. Then we get those little pens. We have, this was last, this last Friday teaching, and let's get a new one here, and let's see how to divide this. Okay, I'm going to divide it into four parts, and Okay. You have in heaven your original self. Okay. Your original self. We short form call that your OS. And here on earth, we give new words for that. Here on earth, we call that the AS, the avatar self. Your avatar self. So you're literally sensing two beings. To explain this phenomena, in which the time continuum is beyond us, we use this new vocabulary. The one who is seated in the heavenly places right now is your original self. And remember, this was even before time exists. Because he blessed you in the heavenly places before the foundation of the world. So your original self is always up there. Then, now your consciousness on this earth, which this life only lasts for at most 120 years. In David's time, 70, 80, but 120 years in our modern time is a good lifespan. And we don't have 120 years, in fact, we've got less than 50 years left before the rapture. And this time continuum that we came into, the part of your consciousness that came, is called your avatar self. And it's this here, your avatar self. This is your original self. And the thing that we taught last week, and you have questions and answers last week, is how to connect between the two. How to connect between the two, to have a dual consciousness. A dual consciousness. The more dual consciousness you have, the more God can do in your life. Your example and my example is our Lord Jesus Christ Himself. Was Jesus constantly conscious of who He was in God? Yes, He was. That's why He could make statements like, before Abraham was, I was. Then He makes statements like, I come from heaven, you are of the earth, He told the people. So Jesus was constantly tapping upon His original self. He knew His avatar self was just an avatar self. And His avatar self yielded. Remember, an avatar is supposed to be an avatar. And you know the definition for avatar. Avatars are an extension of yourself. When you play a computer game, you choose an avatar. And the avatar can look like anything. It might not even look like you. You could be fat, short, chubby. Your avatar could be tall, dark, handsome. You could be male. Your avatar could be female. Can you see? Your avatar has nothing to do with you in the computer game. And your avatar is a representation of you. And then whatever you do on the avatar is controlled by you. So the avatar must remember, your avatar in a computer game, because today's AI is not so intelligent yet, although it's quite intelligent for some robots. But God help you if the day your avatar come alive. And you're playing the computer game and your avatar says, I don't want you to move me now. And you say, what? And then instead, your avatar says, I like to now move you. And then you look like a movie. In the movie, the computer now controls the human being. Oh, God help you. Right? Only happens in movie, not in real life. So we know an avatar is supposed to be an extension of you. It's like your hand. If your hand moves, that moves. And depending on what kind of avatar, they could invent an avatar like a robot, where it's direct transmission from your mind or your thoughts or your movement. So it's possible that, for example, they haven't come to that stage in diving yet, but let's say in deep sea diving or in outer space or whatever, you could put on something that you see everything that your avatar is 1,000 miles away or 1,000 kilometers away. And then when you move right, it moves right. When you move left, it moves left. And all you have, make sure that you can see everything around you. And you could run and your avatar runs. Now what happens is, your avatar is supposed to be a glove. It is a glove. A glove that you wear either through the internet, programming something else, or in a computer game, controlling it with the controllers and the keyboard. An avatar is supposed to be an avatar. It's not supposed to suddenly decide, I like to now be the original self. That's a horrible thought to think about that. But somebody might write a movie after this. Some of you might be movie directors in the future, write some movies and that.
Already
a movie? The avatar becomes the controller. There is a movie like that. Okay, right. So haven't caught up on movies yet. But okay. When we look at your avatar here, remember, we must. The difference between this avatar that we have against computer games or some robotic thing that we control, the difference is all those games don't have AI or brain or intelligence given. Whereas our avatar was given some level of cognition, some level of function to run by itself. That's so advanced that the world cannot comprehend. That when we came forth to this planet, this avatar self is like a pre-programmed avatar self. You know, like pre-programmed cars or today missiles. Today's missiles are so powerful that they can shoot a missile from any point on the earth. And with GPS programming, they can program the missile. And remember in the Gulf War, it was like a thing, but that was just a sample, where they could shoot a missile, and the missile could turn left, and turn right, and it hit a target in Iraq. Today, there is nothing. Because everybody got GPS. And they just had to put a GPS sensor, and as long as the satellite system works, and the missile is intelligent. The missile can turn. And the programmer don't have to turn for the missile. You know what would be good? You know, I have one idea. You know, we can have a new type of air force that is based on avatars. That means there's 100% connection. Already got. Okay. And then the pilot is actually sitting in a room. Then you might have 100 rooms. So when the pilot wants to go and attack, all the pilot goes into the 100 rooms. And each one control one plane. And then the plane don't have to be big enough because, you know, it's cheaper. If the plane had to carry oxygen, carry this, and that, it's very heavy. Now all the plane has to carry is a GPS system and weapons. Because now it sounds like a war, man. But just illustration. In war, a lot of inventions came about. Do you know that within 100 years, we achieved outer space flight because of war? They had to invent greater and greater things. So sometimes good come out of that. And so then each pilot controls his own plane. And then the plane will go up. And if the plane crashes, the pilot is still safe. And so you got what I call avatar pilots. And so the plane takes off, shoom, 10 of them. And you can imagine. And they are so small, hard to shoot. But they're big enough to carry weapons. And they can go at attitudes that humans cannot go, depending on the engine. And so you might have 100 planes for warfare. And they go shoom. And various formation, that's another thing, right? Maybe another movie. But you can see that when God gave us an avatar, God gave some consciousness to this avatar so that it has a feedback loop and it has enough consciousness to be pre-programmed to how to react. Like today you have cars that can drive themselves, and within the next 10-20 years, when you buy a car, having an autopilot might be normal, like having aircon. So it's up to you. You can press a button and then you can read your book while the car is taking you on the driver's seat. And then you want to enjoy driving, you press a button to take manual control and then you control it again. So those might be the cars that we drive in 20 years time or 30 years time if technology continues, you know, with the interruption by the tsunami in 2029. But all it has is a program. And today's system is so powerful that you can program something into a missile or into anything, and then you just press a button, and then that's it. They just have to watch what it does through satellite system. It can go up, turn left, turn right, keep circulating until whatever time is programmed to do anything. And yet you can still send programs to it. Of course, then the next danger is this. You know what's the next warfare? The ability to take over control. And break the code between you and that. Take over control and then use it against it. Whoa, new warfare. Right. So, you know, when men invent something, another one will invent counter weapon, and then there will be no end. And then we use all this for war and destruction, which is not the way God intended. But enough illustration of how an avatar can exist and independent. So there's a lot of difference. It has some level of cognitive function separate from the original self. The question we ask, did God insert some program into us before he let loose this avatar on the earth? The answer is yes. And these are the scriptures. Scripture number one, we know that there was, excuse my word, I'm going to use a computer word, a program. There was a program. Now, I put it up there because I want to show that there was a program design before you came down here. I want to talk about the difference between what happened up there and what happened down here. Something happened. Obviously, something must have happened. Which is why some people don't make it back. Instead of the word program, the Bible word is the word books. A book. A book about your life. So that book is found in the book of Psalms 139, which you all know the verse, 139. We always must support with scripture any doctrine or understanding. Psalms 139 tells us here, in verse 13 onwards, should I start there? Yes, that's fine. Let's start verse 16, cut time short, verse 16. Your eyes saw my substance, being yet unformed. In your book, they were all written. Wow, the program has been written. So can you see from a computer perspective? The program has already been recorded. What this avatar on earth supposed to do? Every single human who came to the earth came with a pre-programmed avatar. It was designed up there. Took a long time. Designed and trained, some level of training also, and all those things were fashioned. He said, continue on. The days were fashioned for me. So the word fashion comes from the Hebrew word yaza. It means they were to squeeze into shape, to mold, but more clearly, to determine. Can you see the word? To determine a resolution. In the Bible days, they don't have computers. So they don't describe things the same way. But it was like predetermined. A shape or form or path that it must take. That's what the word fashion means. Our modern word, program. Our DNA program, what shape your body will be. If it's affected, it can become obese. Our DNA program, what color hair you will be. Our DNA program, what color eyes you will have. What color skin. Our DNA also program how tall or short you are. Shape, form, all in the program. We have new illustrations of illustrated things in the Bible. So that's the word fashion. It says, the days were programmed or fashioned for me when they don't exist yet. They don't exist yet. The reality hasn't come. The physical reality of the avatar does not exist yet. But it's all the programming that is done. That's why I put it in the upper portion of outside the diagram. So here, I would put, based on the picture here, the programming and the book will be Psalms 139. Right? We got the scriptures and the books and the program. Number two, if you write a program for a car and insert it in the car, you must make sure the car has wheels to run on. Right? You don't write a program for a car and put it into a chair. Of course, it can't function. So the physical avatar must be suitable for the program to run. You cannot put a missile program into a car because the car cannot go to outer space. The outward design of the avatar must suit the program. A car is made to run on wheels, unless you got a jet car or flying car, which is different. Then you need a different program for flying car. So a program for a helicopter must enter the helicopter. A program for a missile must go to a missile. A program for a robot to walk. Nowadays, the technology... I remember the first time, about 20, 30 years ago, when the first time they programmed the robot to walk, it was like a whole world clap. Right? The first time when the robot can walk on two legs. And you remember the one of the first RoboCop movie? When RoboCop fight against another robot. The robot was bigger, better, more powerful, more machine, more destructive power. But the robot couldn't climb stairs. So it goes, and robot climbed RoboCop climbed the stairs and then just wipe it up. Simple thing, couldn't climb stairs. But today's robot can climb stairs, can walk like human, can run, can play football. There are football games between robots now to improve the thing. Wow, the world is changing. And nobody is clapping. If today you go back and buy all the things from hardware shop, everything, put together a robot that can walk, nobody is cheering now. You got to take what is already there and improve something beyond that. So the only thing now they are making robots more and more humanoid. And remember the first time they made a robot can smile? It came out in Time magazine. Everyone was coming. Now almost every robot got mimic human expressions. Nothing new now. They're really improving. Who knows, one day, you know, in 30 years time, the robot's so good that when you say hello, you don't know, are you a robot? You're not sure whether it's a robot because they make the skin, everything, color, everything almost as real. You never know. You know, by that time, humans, okay, better don't go into that. Leave it for the movies again. Okay. Now, the second thing, as I mentioned, the program must suit the avatar, correct? The shape, the form, everything. And so, which means, number two, the DNA of the avatar. The DNA of the avatar that is sent down here, must create the physical shape and form for that. And that DNA programming, or that physical thing, is found in Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2. When it says, let's look at this. Ephesians chapter 2 verse 10. It says, we were created by God. It says, for we are His workmanship. Workmanship. Want to know the Greek word? Poiema. We are His product. See, we are the product that God has made. We are the avatar that God has made. And the fabric, the workmanship, the thing that is made. And that thing that is made is your avatar. So that's your avatar DNA. And so we have in Ephesians chapter 2, avatar DNA or DNA for avatar that commands it to take shape and form, to whatever shape and form it is found from Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. We needed that. All these are done before we came down here. Determined. Now, having gave us a program, having created a product, but it's to come down here and be inserted into us here. Because we are humans, excuse me for using these words, the factory is already down here. Factory of human beings. That exists from the time of Adam and Eve. It's already down here. All kinds of mixture, except that it has fallen. Something changed. He has fallen. So God is not going to send a new product down. He did that only twice. Huh? He did twice. First time from Adam. When Adam was created, God actually created a shape like Adam. Remember in Genesis chapter 2, He formed together the shape of Adam, and it was perfect, except it needed the life of God. Then when God breathed into that full-scale Adam's body, Adam became a living soul. Adam became a living soul. That's the first time he ever did it with a new fresh product. Second time was when Jesus came. Jesus is known as the last Adam, the second man. So it tells us that Jesus was not going to take any of this. Okay, let me do the bit different color. Let's take black. He was not going to take any of these polluted materials after sin nature. Jesus cannot be born with sin nature. So for Jesus, He must create a new substance. He didn't have to create Adam, a full-scale body. He just had to create a tiny little fetus or one-cell human, and Jesus comes into it. Because the spiritual world is not limited by the size and dimension or geography of the physical world. So if you have a question in theology that we always ask in Bible college or seminary, there was a very interesting question. How many angels can stand on a pinhead? What kind of theology did you guys learn? No, it was just a hypothetical thing. You know how small a pinhead is? How many angels can stand on that? You know the answer? Infinity. Because they are not limited by space or size. Infinity. Because the physical dimension does not limit the spiritual dimension. So here we have Jesus in all His godliness and fullness can come into any size. God could have created a full form and then He came, but then if He did that, we miss all the growing up stage that we need to learn from. So Jesus also came to teach us how to live this life. So He must start like we start. So God decided to create a living substance in Mary's womb. Which means that nothing from Mary's DNA was used. Because if God used Mary's DNA, and He just created the male DNA, you know, there's the X, and then He created the Y, and then He combined 23 and 23 to make 46 chromosomes. Mary's DNA has sin nature. Christ will have sin nature. So He could take nothing from Mary's DNA. It has to be freshly created. But it's hidden from the world. Only Mary knew, boom, something created in her. Wonder what it felt like. You know one of the mysteries that most men don't know? What it's like to have a baby.
Thank God for that.
Okay, okay, thank God for that. Okay, thank God for the woman. Okay. So yeah, I thought thank God you don't have to be pregnant. Okay. Okay. And so
I'm
coming.
Coming,
is it?
Next week.
What's happening next week?
Mother's Day.
Oh, Mother's Day, yeah. Oh, remind me of Mother's Day. Am I around? Yes, I'm around. Yes. And Mary must have felt something inside her. Whatever it was. But since you're talking about movies, if it were a movie, they have to have some effect. So when the spirit came on her, ding, something happened. Some music or something came into her. She knew something has come in. It was God creating a new human. And nanoseconds later, the spirit of Jesus emptied himself and came into that. So there was absolutely no DNA from Joseph, no DNA from Mary. Mary was purely an incubator. Which actually means this, Jesus could have looked like anything. He didn't have to look like a Jew. He could have looked like a Salonese or Indian. But then, of course, if birth, then people say, right? He could look like Chinese. Oh. He could look like Indian. Oh. He could look like Mongolian. But it will be too frightening. Right? So, whatever shape, form, culture, so to make it easier for acceptance. I mean, Jesus didn't want to be born in such a way and then suddenly he doesn't look like his parents at all. No, God is merciful. He looked pretty Jewish. So that when he's born, people say, okay, you know, he can hide among the Jews. He can hide among the Jews. Be like one of them, but not them. Identify with them, but not them. Because he was different. Technically, he could have looked like anything. He could have looked like Adam. And come and say, whoa, the skin is shiny. Where's the light coming from? And everybody will accept him as a Messiah even if he's born. And Jesus doesn't want that. So he clothed himself as human as possible. And when he was given birth and he came out, his avatar was just nice. There was a programming that was done to his avatar. God never took from this section here. But unfortunately for you and I, the third factor had to be determined. This is the third factor. Since God was not going to do the same like Jesus, for us, we are humans. He came as a God. We have to flow with. If Adam fell, all of us have to be also fallen under Adam. So for us to come, a third determination that God has to do through His Spirit. He has to study all the humans on the earth. Okay, let me make bigger. Dots are too small for you to see. Can you see this tiny dot here?
Can I?
Your eyesight is so good.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Hey, Petra, can you see this dot here?
Yes.
Whoa! Very good. Okay. He has to take, but for the sake of those who can't. Alright, let's make the dot a little bit bigger. Okay. These represent humans. Okay. So, let me make the square for men. The circle for girls. He has to choose the type and kind of DNA from among all this that is there, and choose what I call a time frame and what I call a DNA resonance. Resonance means it's as close as possible to this number two that they can program into. And so he choose for you and I. There's a process where he choose a male and a female father that you and I can be born in. And this choice that is made is based on 1, 2, and 3rd factor that is there. So there was a complex process of choosing which time you come in. Which time you come in depends on number one. Can you see that? What is your purpose on earth? What's your mission? Everybody cannot choose to come at the same time. The God said, how many of you like to come at the time of Jesus? Then all the human race, 6 billion born at the time of what? Jesus. And then the rest are nobody born. No, here's a spreading out as a story. As a story. And so, there were choices made. Now the choices that were made was quite sophisticated. And generally is shortlisted to the top 5 possible families. So you got family A, B, C, D, E to be born in. Yes. But not just your choice. We only advise. We're not so clever. We need the Holy Spirit and the Father God. So the Father God would recommend these are the, and actually in heaven I saw it, they are like books and files. Even, remember the day special for you? God has his first choice family, second choice, which roughly produce the type of DNA you need. So let's say if your destiny is to be a swimmer, so the natural build of your parents and the DNA will make you like big feet, broad shoulders, huge hands, because you're supposed to be a champion swimmer. But if the choice was to be, let's say, a nerd, you don't necessarily need to be very muscular. All you need is to be very brainy. And so they choose parents that are like more on the, will produce in you, when they come together, the sufficient memory power for you to develop. Right? No point not giving enough memory, giving enough brain power, and then you got more brain power, less brain power than you could, than you need and cannot. It doesn't fulfill your destiny. And let's suppose you're supposed to invent something or do some things important. And then that it's more complicated than that. I make it very simple. It depends. Like the desire to fly or to be adventurous. Or sports thing. Some people are born more sporty, some are born more brainy, you know. Very few people have everything. And that comes to another point. With all those choosing, you have to, number 4, you must incorporate strengths and weaknesses, S and W. Not E and W, that's a different thing. I don't even know what E and W stands for. No more in Singapore. Oh, close down. Okay. Okay, I don't know what it stands for, but not AW, but SNW. That is strengths and weaknesses. Strengths and weaknesses. Because for us, see, Jesus came to be the Christ. We came to find Christ on earth. Because Christ has to be found on earth. If you come to know Christ up there, like one of the angels you can be, but not like one of the humans. In order to find Christ, you must have a need in your life. If you come without any needs, you will never come to Christ. There must be something that brings you back to Christ. Some needs or some situation that will bring you to Christ. And if we ask the question, why do we in heaven so happy and everything, why do we want to come down? Because we wanted to know God more. When Christ came, we knew that if we don't follow Him, we cannot advance like He did. And not everyone was given the opportunity to come. So if you are here already, it's obviously good choice. Hallelujah. Man, the strengths and weaknesses that you have to inherit before you come down here, that's very important. They all survey to make sure that they can come back to again this destiny. And you have one and two are the most important. And the others are factors that added up to bring its fulfillment to what we are supposed to go on. Which comes down to this situation that I'll do quickly summarize and second service teach a bit more. What does it mean by the perfect will of God? The perfect will of God, you see, is all determined down here. What is the perfect will of God? This, and to save time, I quote from from Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. Present your body as a living sacrifice, that you may not, and do not be conformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may know what is the good, acceptable or permissive or perfect will of God. That you may know which is the will of God. And so we get such a thing. Perfect will of God in your life means all your choices, your avatar's program, choose correctly and you're walking, and you might have sidetracked on all these things, but in the end you're walking 100% according to the book. That's a perfect will. Permissive will. Permissive will means that you are not following the book. You are not following the book. Maybe some parts of the book. So permissive will means that there are different percentages between, okay, let's say failure is, let's take our human objective. Let's take failure is 49% and below. So
60%.
You want 60% pass mark. Okay, good. Let's take, he got high standards, benign. Okay, benign standard, let's say 60.
Maybe just pass or pass.
Okay. 60% to 99%. Remember, perfect will is 100%. So 1% less, you got 1% imperfection. Then, out of God's will is anywhere from 0 to, let's say, 59. Since 60% is Pinaya's passing mark. Okay, if too high, talk to him after the service. So whatever percentage, these are just illustrating that we can go below certain things. And what happens when you go below? And here's the key that you need to know before we end this service. What is causing perfect, permissive, and outside God's will? You know what's causing it? Since our avatar runs on a program, you have been reprogrammed. Wow. You have been hijacked. Literally, you had a virus infestation. How does the devil reprogram us? Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. Through the world. And look at, isn't virus a program? A virus physically is a snippet of DNA that locks into your normal DNA and changes it. A bacteria is different, it's bigger than a virus. A bacteria is a life form that attacks your body. They're tiny life form. But a virus are snippets of DNA that locks into the DNA and changes the program. So physically, your body is already can be attacked by viruses and bacteria. Two forms of attack. spiritually, you can be attacked that way. That is why we are told in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, every thought must be brought to Christ. Worldly thoughts can become an obsession and temporarily reprogram you. In robot warfare, wasn't the first Terminator kidnapped and reprogrammed and sent back in time? So, the key in this warfare is realize the devil is using that. And the world contains enough of the thoughts and influence that try to reprogram people. It becomes an obsessive thoughts. It becomes what 2 Corinthians 10 calls strongholds. What is it, stronghold? It's not a stronghold over your avatar. It tells your avatar to do things that it was not programmed to do. So, since our avatar needs 100% of program, anything less means it has been hijacked and reprogrammed to that extent. So, we got a lot more things to do in the second service. In the second service, I will talk about real examples. I will ask examples like, when David was with Bathsheba, was that perfect plan or permissive plan? And why it happened? When Jeroboam was given a chance to be the king of the north, was that an additional program or was that an original? See, we got all these questions to ask on predestination and pre-existence, that we will answer all of them. Enjoy your chicken rice first or your lunch and then listen to the message afterward if you cannot come back. But for now, we got enough time to tell us that the end of this sermon, the message that we can bring, we got to bring it to conclusion is, be careful what you think. And then, that is found in many places, renew your mind. Be careful what you say. Because saying is like a sealing of the program into you. Saying is like pressing the enter button. And be careful what you do. Because doing is like wiping off your old program. Wow. All in the Bible, but I have a fresh look from a different perspective. From predestination and pre-existence area. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your grace and your mercy. We ask, O God, as we learn about our original self and our avatar self, that our avatar will be yielded to the original self all the time. Sometimes our avatar just needs education and teaching and learning. Sometimes, Lord, we just need to come to you to say, let your will be done and not our will. As we surrender, you can refresh the programs that are lost. And you impart into us the lost programs, the lost parts, so that we can go back to doing your perfect will. Let your perfect will be done in each life. Let your grace and mercy be great. For we've been programmed for good works to walk in them. Establish your good works in each one. In Jesus' name, and everyone say, amen. It's a good clap. Happy God bless you. Amen.